Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to another webinar of the Animal Welfare Group Nigeria. I am Dr. Yasiri Oluwaseun Sira. I'm the coordinator of the Animal Welfare Group Nigeria, and I'm happy and excited to welcome each and every one of you to today's meeting. And the Animal Welfare Group Nigeria was founded in 2019. After a meeting with students and researchers, where we deliberated about the importance of animal welfare, and we came together as a group to see how we can move forward animal welfare in Nigeria. And within 3 years, we've been able to get other people in Nigeria join the group. So we have members, over 80 members in different affiliation in the country. And we've been doing webinars since, and in the last 3 years, we have been able to do 33 webinars, 6 virtual inaugural lectures, and 1 panel discussion. And our webinar for 2023 has started, and this will be the third in the series for 2023. So you're highly welcome. I really appreciate each and every one of you for participating in today's meeting. So our presenter is Fahmi Idris Firdaus. He's an Indonesian young researcher with research interest in wildlife conservation, ethology, ethnobiology, and ethnoconservation, as well as animal welfare. He got his Bachelor of Science in Forestry Engineering in 2021. And Masters of Science in Biomanagement in 2022, both from School of Life Sciences and Technology, Institute Teknologi Bandung, Indonesia. I hope I got that correct. At the moment, he works as a research assistant of ornithological ethnoconservation for K. Lisa Yang Center for Conservation Bioacoustics, Cornell Lab for Ornithology, Cornell University. So he will be presenting on the untold story of Javan Deer in Indonesia. So without wasting time, I would like to invite Fahmi to give his presentation.
My name is Fahmi Idris Firdaus, and I come from Indonesia. And today I want to present my presentations entitled The Untold Story of Javan Deer, an alternative strategy to improve the conservation in Pangandaran Nature Reserve, West Java, Indonesia. This was my bachelor and master's thesis that I was supervised by Ibu Dr. Rina Ratnasi Purnamahati and also Bapak Dr. Elham Sumarga, from both of them from School of Life Sciences and Technology, Institut Teknologi Bandung. And now I am working as a research assistant to Benjamin Marion, PhD candidate from K. Lisa Yang Center for Conservation Bioacoustics, Cornell Lab of Ornithology, Cornell University, United States of America. So I hope that I can make this presentation as interactive as I can. Let's move to the next slide. And this is the guideline or the outline of my presentations. The first one is introductions, and also the next one is the research, and the third one is strategy, and the fourth is the impact of my research. So before we are going further, I want to show my content disclaimer. This presentation is proposed to raise awareness of wild animal welfare. The views, opinions, and data shown in this presentation are not aimed to judge any party with their activities. If you have a complaint or recommendations about something or find your content is being used incorrectly in these presentations, please contact me in person. Okay, for the first part of my presentations, that is introductions. So where do I live? This is the world map, and this is my country, Indonesia. Yep, this is the map, and I am here in Java Island, the most populated island in the world. And this is the place that I did my research, which is Pangandaran Reserve, located in the west part of Java Island, in this small spot of it. And the purple border is the nature reserve, which is managed by the Natural Resource Conservation Agency of West Java, BBKSDA Jawa Barat. And then the red one is PNTP, or Pangandaran Nature Tourist Park, that is managed by the government-owned company Perhutani. And this is the deer in Indonesia. Six of these animals are actually deer because they are included into the family of Cervidae. We have some bird deer, Javan deer, that the one that I will present in. And then the other one is Axis kuhli, and the manjek deer, and also the yellow manjek deer. All of these five are native to Indonesia, but I think that some bird deer also living in some part of the world like India and also the mainland of Southeast Asia. We also have the Indian spotted deer as we introduce them to the several points on and several corners of Indonesia. And I also, I'm also presenting the other deer. To be honest, this is not the real deer because they are included into Tragulidae, but the term of deer is used for naming them as known as they are mouse deer, or we call it in Bahasa Indonesia is kancil. And yeah, why did I do the research on Javan deer in Pangandaran? So this is the common phenomena that we will see when we come to Pangandaran Beach. We can see that the deer roaming outside the conservation area, which is Pangandaran Reserve, or we can call it PNR. And maybe for several people, it's just a common and they are happy to see the wild animals roaming close to them when they are on their vacations. But me, because I have some kind of interest with the wildlife conservation, I think that it is not just a sudden that the deer roaming outside the area. So yeah, after that, I saw that the deer feeding on the trees, and since that time, I thought that is not correct, and that is not normal for wildlife animal. And after that, I also see this kind of, wow, this is very terrible because I saw the wounded deer. Yeah, we don't know about the factor of it, but we know that this one was roaming outside the area. And after that, the staff of BBKSDA Jawa Barat and also the PNR staff take some medical actions of the male Javan deer. So he is healing up to this day. So this is the untold story of why I did my research on Javan deer in Pangandaran Reserve. The first one in 1910 to 1920, it was the hunting ground where deer and buntings were introduced. This is the deer and also this is the bunting. This is the bunting has the scientific name as Bos Javanicus, so they are wild cattle, and this is buntings of Pangandaran in 1970s. And I got this picture from Google, and this one is the more clearer photo of Javan buntings. And in 1934, the deer and buntings population increased in Pangandaran. The area changed to be the first wildlife reserve in Indonesia, or at the time it was Dutch East Indies. And after the independence of Indonesia in 1945, in 1961, Rafflesia palma was discovered in the area, changed the status of the area to be a nature reserve. So you can see the comparison of size of human hands compared to the size of the flower, so it's kind of big for a flower. Okay, In 1982, Mount Galunggung in Tasikmalaya erupted, and then the volcanic ash covered the vast surrounding area, including the Pangandaran Nature Reserve. It's based on the literature that is Roslin and Suzuki 2012. And as the volcanic ash covered the feed plants, the photosynthesis stopped, causing a lack of food for deer and bantengs. Deer and bantengs struggled for food by roaming outside the conservation area. And after that, the deer had survived and is surviving up to this day, but the banteng was extinct in that area. Obviously the PNR staff did efforts, but yeah, it gave small impact on it. So from that kind of phenomena, the deer is surviving, but they have the change of behavior and activities of their lives. And on the other hand, the grassland have been having challenges, which is natural successions. And this is the one of the grasslands in Pangandaran Nature Reserve. So actually, Pangandaran Nature Reserve had three grasslands. They were Cikamau, Badeto, and Nanggorak. But Badeto and Nanggorak had grown and as a secondary forest, and the last one is Cikamau, which is now surviving as a feeding ground for the deer. So let's move to the second part of my presentations, which is the research, the ecology part. So this is the outline of my research. The first one is about the issue, which is the untold story, and then I went to the strategic plan of the PNR that I get this one from, reviewing every documentations and also files that the PNR has. And after that, I just put them as ecological part and also the management aspect. And after that, I have the detail of the ecological conditions, which included Javan deer encounter, and then daily behavior of Javan deer, and also the habitat carrying capacity. And also the second one is for conservation management PNR, including management of the deer welfare, and then the management of the habitat. And after that, I also use the literature for my data collections and analysis. And after that, I process my data collection and analysis into the SWOT, strength, weakness, opportunity, threat analysis. And after that, I also use the quantitative strategic planning metric, or QOSPM. And after that, I got the alternative strategy to improve the conservation of Javan deer in Pangandaran Nature Reserve, West Java, Indonesia. So this is the first first part of the data. I have the Javan deer encounter in Pangandaran Natural Tourist Park. It is something like this. Okay, this research was carried out at three locations in PNTP, and also three locations outside the PNTP or tourist destinations in the morning and afternoon. And most of the deer spend their time outside PNTP and come back to the conservation area at 5 to 6 p.m. Sometimes the PNR staff heard them back to the conservation area. And we can call the herd outside the conservation area as the outer group. And then the highest number of deer by encounter was 42 deer, including the inner group, when they were seen at the shoreline in PNTP. Okay. So here I'm showing the Javan deer encounter in Cikamau, which is Cikamau is the part of Pangandaran Nature Reserve, and it is separated from PNTP. So this is the graph of the number of the deer. And this one is the temperature of the Chikamal grassland and also the forest area. So we call the herd as the inner group that consists of 8 deer as a single group and solitary males. We also found a one-leaf Balinese cow, this one. Balinese cow was reintroduced to the area as the replacement of the now extinct bantengs. And the Balinese cow joined the herd of 8 deer. I also found the feral dogs in the area. And then there are several activities of humans in the area, which is not allowed for public. And yeah, we are just we are still working on it to see why. So from this graph, we see that the number of deer is the reverse with the Chikamal grasslands temperature, which if the temperature is low enough for them, they will gather in the grasslands. But if the temperature is growing up during the day, they will hide and go to the shaded area of the forest surrounds the grassland. And here the Javan deer behavior in Pangandaran. As what I have said, we have the two groups of them, which is the inner and outer group of deer. This is the the data that I have got from the field that I work on the inner group of the Javan deer in Pangandaran. As you can see that in this time, I didn't see the deer in the Chikamal grasslands. So it is empty. And all of them have the most behavior on feeding. And also they have more alerting mode than the behavior of the outer group of the deer. So this is the data from Witaningsi at all 2020. It is kind of a different behavior, as you can see that. Yeah, and this is the first time in the Pangandaran history, conservation history, that the group of the deer scientifically announced as the separate group. So this is the inner one and this is the outer one. They have a different behavior in their daily lives. And this is the habit productivity and carrying capacity. As I have mentioned that I was not working only with the animal, which is the Javan deer, but also working on the habitat productivity and carrying capacity. So we can see here, Chikamal grassland has the highest one because, yeah, it has the widest area, which is 4.4 hectare. To be honest, this is not a huge area if we are talking about the area in forestry, but you know that, Chikamal is the most important feeding ground today in Pangandaran Reserve. Chikamal grassland has carrying capacity for 18 deer per year. And it's like, it is not enough to hold the 42 individuals of the deer. So yeah, it is valid to say that the reason why the deer in Pangandaran Nature Reserve went outside and roaming outside the conservation area because there is a lack of food inside the conservation area. So this is what I have done with this part of research, the evaluations of feed plans for day 20 and 50 in 30 plots at Chikamal and also 12 plots in PNTP. And the plot size is 1 square meter. And this is the percentage of understory plants in grazing areas of PNR. In Chikamal, Cynodontactylon dominated the area and followed by the Axonus compressus. And the others also dominating the area, but they are non-feed plants like this one, Zephyranthus sp. And then let's move to the research, which is the management aspect. The first one is the management of the deer welfare. So this is the staff of PNR. They did best effort to conserve the deer in the Pangandaran Nature Reserve. Like they are herding and also evacuating the deer to come back to the conservation area. They go like to the residence and also residence area and also to the village to save the deer and then put it back into the conservation area. And after that, they also made some kind of habituation area at Cikamal. It's something like this. It's a square area bordered by a fence made from woods. And but today it was destructed. It was not used anymore. And I think that it is just small enough. It's too small just to habituate the deer. And the other activity that they did is extruding the feral dogs, because this is feral dogs. The dogs are hunting on the deer, and the deer populations also in decreasing because of the hunting by the feral dogs. And after that, we are talking about the management of the habitat. And I got this data from the field. And also I did interviews with the staffs of PNR. And here's what they did and they are doing for the habitat of the deer. The first one, they are doing deforesting, the reforested grassland to maintain the growth of feed plants and eradicate the alien invasive species, particularly teak, like Tectona grandis. It is a wood, and this tree has a wide and broad leaf that shaded the area, and it prevents the understory plants to grow. So yeah, they have to eradicate it. And then the teak will regrow after being cut down. So it's the most challenging activity that they are doing today. And the second one, they are replanting the eradicate area with the feed plants, and they planting Axonopus compressus. And then the third one is open land monitoring is on the PNR's list to do, but the gap is they need to use proper monitoring methods like GIS and qualitative and quantitative data analysis. So this is the conditions of the conservation supporting infrastructures. Yeah, this is on the border of the conservation area and the non-conservation area, and this is also the same. They also have the old watchtower, and also they have destructed. This is like a pond that used for giving the animals water, and also for the pond for the deer wallowing in the mud. But yeah, they are not supporting for the conservation for today. And then the third part of my presentation today is the strategy. So I use SWOT. So this is the internal factors of my research. And I gave the code of every factor that I get from the field data and also from the interviews data. I will not mention all of it, but you can, and all of you can see it through my publications, Firdaus et al. 2023. And this is the external factors that consists of opportunities and also the threats that they are facing during the conservation management of the Javan deer. And then here is the internal factor evaluations and external factor evaluation metrics As you saw that we got the total score of the weighted score from this factor. So we put the score into the matrix and we see that the point of the strategy is in the cell 5. Yeah. Therefore, the directions of the conservation strategy was to hold and maintain. That could be in the form of integrative renewal or improvisations or intensifications of the existing management system. So based on the IFE and EFE metrics, this is the SWOT matrix. In this matrix, I combine this external and external factors to construct the strategy that we can use as an alternative to solve the problems. And here are the strategies. The first one, improving the conservation management of Javan deer and its habitat, and then improving facilities and the management system of those facilities and conservation supporting infrastructures, improving the capability of PNR staff, and also doing collaboration with researchers to perform some research and innovations, educating and empowering the local people, and also to considering the management status of the Javan deer in the conservation management between PNR and PNTP staffs. And yeah, those strategy was not ordered by the priority. So I used the QSPM metric to see which one is the most priority strategies. So based on this metrics and the weight total weighted score, I got the strategies by priority, which is the first one is considering the management status of the Javan deer in conservation area management of PNR and PNTP. As aforementioned, that PNR and PNTP are managed by the different institutions. So, but in other hand, that the deer are roaming both in PNR and also PNTP. So they have to make like agreement and also considering the management status of the Javan deer so they can do the collaborations to improve the conservation of the Javan deer. And then the second one is improving the conservation management of Javan deer and its habitat, like doing monitoring more proper and also improving facilities and the management system of those facilities and the conservation supporting infrastructures. And after that, they have to make more collaboration with researchers to perform some research and innovation for the Javan deer conservations. And then the fifth is improving the capability of PNR staff theoretically and practically, because you know that if they have the better facilities, they also have to have more capability to use and to make it functionable of the facilities. And the last one is educating and empowering the local people in terms of Javan deer, because the conservation area is located close to the local people settlement. So they have to make collaborations and also make communications with the local people in terms of protecting Javan deer. And after that, this is the impact of my research. Okay, since for my bachelor's degree, I also had the collaborations with one of my colleagues, that is Nidita Skania, and we made this map of Chikamal grassland then and now. So as we know that the grassland is threatened by the natural successions. So this is the yellow line illustrates the 20.8 hectare of Chikamal in the 1980s. So it's like kind of the real border of Chikamal. And the purple border illustrates the 4.4 hectare area of Chikamal in 2021. So there a lot of difference between them. And this is the habitat change modeling of Chikamal. As you can see that the method we use is logistic regressions. And then the area under ROC curve or AUC is 0.89. And the red blocks illustrate the red blocks here and here illustrate the area with the higher risk of land cover changes. So yeah, this is the map that we have modeled using logistic regression. And then the next one, we also made the rehabilitation design of the habitat of Javan deer at Chikamal grassland, PNR. So the first rehabilitation design was intensifications. It means that managing the risk of land cover change in today's Chikamal by eradicating the non-feed alien invasive plants and replanting the area with local feed plants as exonomous compressors is the most recommended one. And then the next one is extensifications, managing the risk of land cover changes in surrounding area of today's Chikamal with limitations to the 1980s border by eradicating the non-feed alien invasive plants that are mostly thick trees or Tectona grandis, and replanting the area with local feed plants, as I have mentioned in the intensification part. And this is the analysis of carrying capacity before and after the rehabilitations. So for today's Chikamal, as aforementioned, the carrying capacity is 18 deer per year. And after intensifications, the carrying capacity is growing up to 20 deer per year. And after intensification plus extensifications, they will have the carrying capacity of 41 deer per year. And this is like the next step of my rehabilitation design. This kind of my creativity with my colleague, which is Nidita Sakania, that is the habituation area. So as I have mentioned in the previous slides, that there was like habituation fence inside of Chikamal grasslands, and they are not enough to hold all of the populations of Javan deer. So I have made this design in order to make the proper habituation area. The blue line illustrates the border of the habituation fence to habituate the behavioral change Javan deer. So this one. And then the habituation fence should surround the grassland as a feeding ground. And also some patches of forest is the shaded area with 30 hectare area in total. So I have, as we need, we know that the deer not only working on feeding every day, but also they need to hide from the scorching sun. So they need a shaded area for them to be protected from the heat of the day. So this is the references that I have used for my presentations. And from this research, I have published two papers, and I have also published a presentation in a national seminar of Masyarakat Biodiversitas Indonesia. And yeah, that's all. And my gratitude expressed to my mom, dad, and my beloved family, my supervisors, Ibu Dr. Rina Ratnasi Purnamahati, and Papa Dr. Elham Sumarga, and also gratitude expressed to PNR staff and BBK SDA Jawa Barat staff, and then also the Department of Forestry Engineering and Department of Biomanagement, Institut Teknologi Bandung, and then I also thank you to Lazis Muci Amius for funding my study, and also I also my gratitude expressed to Nindita Sakenia for being part of our team, and then mentors, friends of mine, and anyone involved. And I also would like to express my gratitude to Animal Welfare Group of Nigeria, AWGN, and UFAW for arranging this webinar. And also thank you to Dr. Iyasi for this opportunity. That's all from me, and thank you very much.
Thank you so much for this interesting presentation on the conservation of the Javan deer. This will be the first time we'll be having such a presentation on deer on this group. And I really appreciate the good work you're doing in increasing awareness in Indonesia. So to the audience, if you have questions for the presenter, kindly drop it in the chat box. Yeah. So I will start with my question because I'm yet to find any question in the chat box. I noticed in one of your figures, it seemed to me that the deer spend a longer time feeding. So please, can you just talk about what their GIT looks like? Is it close to the ruminants, or how do they process their food? Sorry, let me unmute here.
Okay, excuse me, Mama, can you repeat the important part of your questions?
The question is looking at the daily behavioral pattern of the deer. They seem to spend a longer time feeding. So the question is, what does their gastrointestinal tract look like? Is it close to the, are they ruminants or hindgut fermenters or what?
Yeah, they are ruminants. And yeah, as you know, that ruminants will process their foods like twice or more. And yeah, during the day, they not only picking up the food from the plants, but also they during the ruminating, it could be like they are resting under the shaded area and then keep chewing on the food. So yeah, they are ruminants.
So does that mean that what you classify as feeding is a combination of the time they were taking the grass and also ruminating?
Yeah, thank you. For part of my research on the deer behavior, that is especially for the feeding, it's not only picking up the grass from the land, but it's also including the ruminating and also the suckling for analyzing the behavior activity of the fawn, the deer young. And then yeah, it is not only for picking up the food from the plants, but also foraging and also ruminating and also suckling.
Okay, thank you so much. I think the questions are coming in now. Yeah. Okay. So there's a question from Sanusi. Do you have problems of illegal hunting of this deer?
Illegal hunting. If we are talking about the deer in Javan, in Pangandaran Reserve, there is no hunting of the deer. But if we are seeing to the other part of Indonesia, as like Komodo National Park, maybe, because I have read several news that there are so many hunters hunting on the deer on that island, so it is a problem on the other side of conservation area in Indonesia. But for Pangandaran Reserve, there is no hunting activities for the deer.
All right, thank you so much. So there's no issue related to hunting of this animal.
Excuse me, Mama. The internet
as in hunting is not a major issue when it comes to the deer, or is it that it's not significant, or probably in your area they don't really hunt the deer? Maybe in other areas it may be an animal that people hunt, and you know, for
meat. To be honest, as general, Javan deer in Indonesian scale, man. The most important problems is hunting, of course, because you know that people think that Javan deer is not a rare species. So there are several people that keep hunting on deer. But on the other side, you know that the deer is also a prey for the carnivores like Javan leopard and also Javan jackals, something like that. And the deer is needed by anyone, but anyone and any carnivore. So the population is decreasing for in general, but in Pangandaran Nature Reserve, the most what is that? The highest problem is not poaching or hunting, but it is the conditions of the habitats. So it depends on the sites we are talking about, because it's different of the problems of the deer.
Yeah, I think you also mentioned that in your presentation that due to volcanic ash, which affects the plant population, and of course, once there is a reduction in the plant population, it will affect the amount of food available for these animals to consume. But I now want to ask, during such a period, do they have any form of adaptive mechanism or a coping strategy that they use during such period, or they just die of hunger? They just remain there or die of hunger?
Okay, since the volcanic eruptions, the deer and also the banteng went out of the nature conservations, and they feed on the like everything that they have found on that site. Like maybe, yeah, it's good if it's still plants like leaf or grass, it's still good. But if it's bad, when they are finding plastics, I mean, human food inside a plastic bag, and they want to eat it, and they ate it with the plastic. So that's the problem, because you know that the plastic cannot be digested well by the deer, and it's harmful for them to eat it.
So
that's the issue.
Yeah, thank you so much. So there's a question here from Ben Mirin. What are some of your ideas for educating local people about the importance of Javan deer? With whom would you start with if you want to educate people on this?
Okay, I think that okay, thank you for the question. Sorry. Thank you. And also thank you for the other previous questions. For educating people, I think the better one way is to educate the people close to the conservation area, because when the deer went out of the conservation area, they will reach the nearby locations, right? So the most important thing is to talk to the people and coordinate with them if there is deer outside the conservation area, and then after that the staff will pick them up back to the conservation area. And I think that it is still working up to this day, but we need also more effective communication way to make it more faster for informing each other, and also to know that educate people about the impact if the deer was extinct from that conservation site. So yeah, that's my efforts, I think, to educate the people around Pangandaran Nature Reserve.
So your education, is it targeted to the general public or maybe to a specific group, maybe the children, the youth, or the elders?
Yeah, I think that if you are approaching the elders, to be honest, it's we have to use different method if we want to teach the younger generation, right? It's like for the elder, we can just educate them directly to the impact about the deer. If the deer is outside the conservation area, and for the youth, I think that best way is to input about the conservation of deer into the school curriculum. That's good. I mean, it's no need to like doing in detailed ways, but just to tell them that this is the impact if the deer and also other species went away from our biodiversity. Yeah.
Well, thank you so much. We have lots of questions for you. What has been the reception of your research and particularly your proposed strategies among local stakeholders?
Okay, so this is from Ben. Hello, Ben. What has been the reception of local stakeholders? Okay, to be honest, I didn't work on the research with the local stakeholders because I wanted to do it, but I think that, and also my supervisors told me that I have to make more focused research. That's why I didn't do the research for the local stakeholders. But to be honest, in Pangandaran area, the head of local community has huge impact to their organization and community. And I think that it is effective if we have like, what is that, collaborations and also working together with the people. And it is more effective if just we talk to the head of the community and then suggested the head of the community to tell their members. So it will more, what is that? Yeah, the strategies goes run down from the head to toe. So it's more effective and it's more applicable because it could be if we teach, if we are teaching them based on our research, it could be too scientific and too hard to tell to them. And we need someone that can tell them about in the right way, so the information can be delivered well. So yeah, approaching the head of the community is like alternative strategy, alternative way to communicate with the local people.
Yeah, it is true, because if you think talking science, not everybody understands science, and you have to bring it to the level of the people in the community, especially probably going through their community leaders, going to their religious leaders, and making them understand the importance of conservation. And then it is through that means that makes it easy for you to be able to reach out to the general community and make an impact, especially when you want to create a change in the way animals are being treated or handled in a place. So thank you so much for that answer. There is a comment here from Said and a question. He said, great talk. Are there any impact of human activities on their predator-prey interaction?
Yeah. In Pangandaran Reserve, to be honest, they don't have a predator. So for the Javan deer, there is no prediction between Javan deer and other predator or carnivores, like maybe it's common like Javan leopard or Javan wild dogs. But I, as I have mentioned, the predator prey interaction is appearing between the deer and the feral dogs. The feral dogs, the dogs that that were pet by the people, and then but the dogs went into the conservation area, and yeah, there is a phenomenon that I see. The feral dogs hunting and also hunting for the deer, and it's like a chaos, and it's very sad because the dog is not supposed to be there, and the deer was like, oh, it's very terrible to talk, but that's the facts. And after that, I also found a head of a deer hunted by the dog. So it's like it's very bad situations, and I talked to the staff because of that phenomenon. So for human activities, it just to be honest, there is an access for like tourists to get into the nature conservations, but in Indonesia regulations, natural conservations cannot be used and cannot be used to take the advantage of, like you cannot use it to take the woods and also to take any animals from it, because it is strictly protected. It's different with the national park in Indonesia, because a national park has the larger area with the system of zones. So there are the zones that humans can use for their daily activities, and the humans can take advantage of their of that zones. And there's also the zone that just only for the animals and also the protected species, both for animals and also the plants. If that we are talking about the national park, but in Cagar Alam Pangandaran or Pangandaran Nature Reserve, the conflict is just the tourists can get the access into the nature conservations, and it affected to the behavior of the deer, as we know that the inner group of the deer has more behavior in alerting, so they are not tolerant to humans existence, so it will make chaos if there are many humans go into their habitats. So maybe that's the most appearing issue when we are talking about the deer in Pangandaran Nature Reserve.
Wow. So will you say that are deers, are they gentle animals? Are they easy to make friends with? Or when we now talk about human-deer interaction, how easy is it for you to, you know, get close to them and, you know, make friends with them, sort of?
Yeah, Javan deer is actually easy to be captivated in captivity, but it's also hard if we see them in wild and if they are the wild ones, because they will like stomping their feet on the ground and also ready to strike on us, and it's really Well, it's dangerous because their antlers is big enough and long enough to attack us as humans, and they don't have any afraid of human if they are, what is that, threatened in wildlife. So yeah, there is possibility for them to run away from human activities, but they also can attack a human if human threaten their activities in that area.
Okay. Well, I just imagine the structure of their horn. How I think the structure of their horn should give them a strength. It should be a strength to them to be able to even attack predators. Or are they just defenseless, even with, despite the fact that they have these big horns?
Okay. I want to make a clarification, ma'am, that they don't have horn.
Oh.
They have antlers. Antlers. So for deer, they don't have horn because horn is formidable and everlasting, right? But for antlers, they will say shed for after the period is approached, like maybe 3 years, and after that they will shed it off, and then they will regrow it. So it's regrowing based on the period time. And the antlers is not only for protecting themselves, but also to show to the, especially because the antlers was only owned by the male deer. They also use it to impress the female deer.
Okay.
Especially during the mating season. So it is not only to protect themselves, but also to show that they have artistic character of themselves. And also it also showed about their territorial manner.
Yeah.
You know that they can take several grass or part of plants onto their antlers, and it was like it's to show the other deer that they have that area, and to impress more female for the mating season.
Okay, thank you so much. So let's quickly go back to the chat box. Here is a question also from Saeed. Is do deers respond to anthropogenic noise? As in, how do they respond to noise in the environment or something?
Okay, for the outer group of the deer in Pangandaran Nature Reserve, they have more tolerant behavior to human activities. Like they don't care about the hustle and bustle of the tourist destination. They don't care about human activities next to their existence on that point. But if we are talking about the inner group, as they are intolerant to human existence, they will they tend to avoid the human existence. So they will walk away or ran away if they see humans, and they will not and they will hide in the shaded area, which is the forest part of the Pangandaran Nature Reserve, and they will reappear to that spot if the human is not there. So yeah, because there are two group of deer in Pangandaran Nature Reserve, and yeah, there are two of differences. There are differences if we are talking about the human tolerant and human intolerant in Pangandaran Nature Reserve.
Well, thank you so much, Fahmi. And there are lots of messages wishing you, saying good presentation, nice presentation. And I think the audience really found this interesting. And there is a question from Sanusi here. Apart from the Javan deer, are there other animals under the conservation program?
Oh, so we are talking in Pangandaran, right? Pangandaran Nature Reserve, right? Okay. Javan deer is not only species protected in that area. To be honest, in Indonesia, that if any species of animal lives in a conservation area, they will be protected. So they are protected. As although they are not rare, if they are in the conservation area, they are protected. So in Pangandaran Nature Reserve, they also have not only deer but also Javan langur, like monkeys, and also they have other rare species like giant squirrel. They have it, and also the most important one is the Rafflesia padma. Rafflesia padma is one of, like, it is not the biggest one, but it's included into the big plants with big flowers and blooms, and it's the specialty of Pangandaran Reserve. So it is not only the deer but also the other species, and the PNR staff have to separate their duties, both from the Javan deer conservation and also the other species.
Well, that is amazing. But I noticed you kept saying Javan deer, Javan this, Javan that. Is it that all the species you have in Javan, you've named them, you know, based on the zone or something?
Yeah, because they are native to Java. Yeah, they are native to Java. And maybe for several species, they are also native to, endemic to Java. So I just call it Javan because there are a lot of Javan animals protected and rare in the field. So yeah, just to make it more specific, that they can be found only in Java Island.
Okay. Yeah. Probably I've not heard you say Javan chicken.
I think we can talk more about it, like Chimani chicken, the old black chicken. It's really interesting to talk about.
Okay, we will do that, not today. Today is for Javan deer. So, right. Says another interesting meeting. Thank you. Thanks to the organizer and the presenter. So there's a question here from Katarina. Thank you for your effort in animal conservation. Just out of interest, how are the feral dogs managed in Indonesia? Are there any shelters at all? It might help to protect the deer.
Okay.
So what do you
think? Okay, so dogs is not every place in Indonesia. You know that Indonesia is a country with majority of the people are Muslim, so we don't pet dogs. But some for several parts of Indonesia that the major of the people are not Muslim, they have dogs as pets. Like, you know, Bali Islands, they have more dogs than maybe Pangandaran has. Pangandaran people have in their daily lives. So there are several, as I know that there are several shelters for the dogs in Indonesia, but it's not a big community because not every place in Indonesia has dog as a stray animal and also as a pet. So yeah, that's it.
Okay, I think with that, I have exhausted all the questions in the chat box. And to all the participants, if you still have further comments for our presenter, kindly indicate. And I can see Saeed, yeah. Do you want to say something? Please unmute Saeed Sabiet.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes, please.
Yeah.
Cool. Thank you very much, Fahmi, for your interesting presentation. And thank you to all of you for organizing such an interesting and great opportunity for us to be here. And yeah, enjoy this interesting presentation. Well, I'm really interested in your presentation, Fahmi, because, well, anthropogenic noise may impact differently in different animals among taxa. So I was wondering, well, how I can say, maybe anthropogenic sound can also have some impacts on their this species communication. So in noisy area that they are living, maybe they higher up their pitch to communicate, or do they communicate with each other with sound? They can produce sounds or not?
Yeah, to be honest, there are several ways that the deer communicate with each other. Like for the deer with deer, they can communicate with the other deer by the scent, because they have scent glands on their bodies, and that's the most important communications, especially during the mating season. And also, yeah, they do have vocalizations, some kind of to, but it's mostly for like to protecting themselves if they are in the threatening situation. So they will like screaming. Screaming, you know, but it's just for the inner group of the deer. But as long as I did my research in Pangandaran, I did not see the deer has the alerting mode to the people when they are outside the conservation area.
Interesting. And maybe a little bit. Another question, maybe is not related, but why they shed their antlers? So is that something? Because I think they males use those antlers to advertise themselves to females. And are there any beneficial or energy costs that they shed their antlers? What are the reasons behind this? Yeah, it's very interesting.
Okay, so it's biological sciences, right? You know that antlers on deer's head, it's like our nails and also our hair. So if we sometimes we need to cut it off, right? So does the deer. That's the biological system. And then but if they are losing their antlers during the mating season, it's like, you know, that the male deer have to fight and to wrestling with each other to win the territorial and also to win the right for the mating. But it is still working if the champion losing the antlers. So yeah, antlers is, yeah, it could be the like, what is that, ornaments of the male deers to show their strength, but it is not the only way to show their strength of their daily life. So that's it, sir.
Oh, thank you so much, Saeed, for that question. And thank you to our speaker, Fahmi, for giving us insights into the life of the Javan deer and the work you're doing in conserving this species. We'll have to wrap up now. I want to appreciate all the participants. Thank you for your time. Thank you for the questions. Thank you for engaging. And thank you for being part of today's webinar. I dropped in the chat box that the animal welfare group would like to do more of storytelling. We would like you to share your stories, because I know this is an audience, is a global audience. We have people from different parts of the world. And if you're interested in sharing your story about your passion for animal, there is the link in the chat box. You just fill it and then Once we are able to get a sizable number of people that are interested, then we'll be able to fix a date for it, and it will just be storytelling. You know, storytelling is one of the major ways of sharing, you know, making people understand different things aside from scientific presentation. Storytelling goes, resonates with the public more than, you know, talking about research and research and research. So we also want to use that avenue to reach out to a whole lot of people who when they listen to your story, they will at least be able to see the reason why animals need to be loved. So thank you once again. I have the link in the chat now, please. And please feel free to share it with your network, with your colleagues. We're happy to even have children. If you have a child that, you know, is always, you know, with a pet or likes doing this and likes doing that with animals and is willing to share his or her story, then we are welcome. We appreciate all. We encourage children and the youths and everybody just to participate. We want to hear from everybody all over the country. Once again, thank you so much for joining the Animal Welfare Group Nigeria. And if you have not followed us on our LinkedIn, our Facebook, and Twitter, please kindly do so that you not miss out on subsequent meetings or information. And also, if today is your first time of joining our webinar, we have the Animal Welfare YouTube channel where previous webinars have been uploaded. So you can just go to our YouTube channel and watch previous webinars. And then from there, you get insight, you get to learn. It's an educational resource. In fact, I tell my colleagues that, in fact, you can even tell your students to watch it and then you discuss that topic in class. Is a way to extend knowledge, is a way to reach out to a lot of people. And when they discuss, of course, they will learn one or two things at the end of the day. So thank you so much for your time. And with that, I'll say bye-bye and see you in the next 2 weeks. Thank you so much and bye.